When you think of anime studios for TV anime, many names come to mind. Bones, Kyoto Animation, Madhouse, Wit Studio, the list goes on. However, when it comes to movies, it was a limited number of names until recently. At least in the West, there were only one studio that people were able to name, that being Studio Ghibli, which wasn't necessarily representative of what was coming out. But for the West, this trend was bucked in 2016 to 2017 with both Your Name and A Silent Voice proving to a Western audience that Ghibli weren't the only studio involved in anime movies. Since then, I've been like a house hunter with the number of studios I've looked at, and recently I've seen a new kid on the block in the form of Studio Colorido, the subject of today's video. So far, they've released three films in cinema, although one of them was also released as an OVA series in the West, so it's more of a 2.8, but bugger it. And I'm going to be reviewing each of them in this video. And you know what that means. I get to slap the word retrospective in the title and put the video into segments using timestamps in the description to make it sound like I'm a professional. And not the kind of self-conscious twat who loses sleep because they didn't make a Shining reference on Halloween as part of a tradition that no one cared about but themselves. God, it feels good pretending I'm not a fucking train wreck. Starting off with their first feature film, Penguin Highway. It is one that I was savoring before my viewing of it. This was for three reasons. One, this was after I watched the two other films I'm going to be talking about later on in this video, so I already had a feel for the quality on display within Studio Colorido. Two, this is based off a novel by Tomohiko Morimi, the same author behind The Tatami Galaxy and Nighty Short Walk On Girl. I read the novel of Penguin Highway a few months ago out of my newfound appreciation for the anime adaptation of the aforementioned Tatami Galaxy series, and as it turns out, the novel of Penguin Highway is pretty fantastic. But the most important reason for me watching it is this. It's got fucking penguins in it. This is the story of Aoyama, a 10-year-old boy who prides himself off their intellect, one day discovering penguins have appeared in his hometown. To get to the bottom of this, as well as other odd circumstances, he and his friends must investigate how they all tie in with the lady that works at the dentist who he has a light crush on. That there was me just describing the plot in 60 to 70 words. However, I can do it quicker in just 3 words. Ada fucking Ada! When I was reading the book, it just referred to her as the lady, and I was thinking to myself, that sounds a bit like an One-san. Little did I know that Aoyama literally refers to her as One-san in Japanese. Hang on a minute, wasn't I actually meant to be talking about a heartwarming story about childhood innocence? Before I get Ara arrested, I should mention that all the One-san stuff was a tangent, and that the core of this film is the sense of whimsical fun and exploration. Aoyama may think that he's the next Jimmy Neutron, but at the end of the day, he's still a kid who's still finding out more about the world as he grows up. And that's ultimately what makes it feel like such a fun watch. The magical realism, like the penguins themselves, are something that you would expect to see more in South America, but the inclusion of it here is a welcome surprise. Despite this film following the novel very well, I found myself forgetting what was coming next because I was just so immersed in everything. The visual element allows me to appreciate each of the characters in more detail, with each of them becoming more endearing than they were when they were just text in a book. Although, I will argue that Uchida kind of got done dirty in the second half, with him having a reduced role. This is a shame because Rie Kugimiya did a great job making him a slightly more likable version of Milhouse from The Simpsons. And another advantage this has over the book is that we get to leave Aoyama's perspective every now and again, and experience developments that the first-person narrative couldn't facilitate, such as a private conversation between adults, or just a very nice focus on a single penguin's walk around town. But that is not to say that it doesn't do a great job at adapting the novel, including my favourite quote from it.
Aoyama-kun,って怒らないね.
This proves that Aoyama is not just a child of science, but also a child of culture. The animation is also bloody top-notch, especially the final set pieces of the film, which are just jaw-dropping. And one last thing I want to talk about is the theme song. I typically have issues with theme songs in anime movies. While there are some exceptions, such as Your Name or Promare, the main theme songs in an anime film are typically reserved just for the ending credits, and this has led me to a few problems with some films. For example, the theme song for Made in Abyss, Dawn of Deep Soul is great, and so is the movie as a whole for that matter. But I was kind of annoyed that it was only saved for the credits, and not used to underscore some of the film itself. But here in Penguin Highway, they do just reserve it for the end credits, but by having this charming yet emotional song at the end, it really accentuates the rather emotional ending to this film, which I won't spoil, but even though I knew it was coming when I watched it, it still managed to keep its impact because of how the song was used. If a song gets me to sit through the entire entirety of the credits, then you know it's done a good job. And it's a good thing I sat through those credits, because the post-credit scene reveals that it was all a part of the Pingu cinematic newtiverse. In conclusion, Pingu in the Suburbs is pretty great. Go read the book, but more importantly, watch this film. 2 years later, in current year at time of recording, Studio Colorido brought out their next film, A Whisker Away, or Wanting to Cry, I Pretend to Be a Cat. And this is an original work written by Mari Okada of Anohana, Makia, and Toradora fame. The protagonist is Muge, a girl who transforms into a cat so that she can get the attention of a boy named Hinode. In order to achieve this, she has a contract with this lardess, who provides her with the mask that allows her to transform. From what I've seen of reactions to this film, Muge seems to be a bit of a Marmite protagonist, in that you could either love her or hate her. I'm in the approve of camp, although I can understand where the criticism comes from. To say that she lightly flirts with Hinode is to say that I'm somewhat allergic to sulfuric acid. However, I can understand where she's coming from in her love-struck ways, even if they are a bit stalkery. She is growing up, and at the same time, her father has just remarried, so it's a complicated situation which she believes that no one cares for, and it's through her interaction with Hinode that she finds comfort. Ultimately, her learning to love those around her who aren't just Hinode serves as the main story arc, and this is a revelation that makes a lot of sense when you realize each of the characters are all likable with their own goals, even if you didn't expect to like them at first. For example, at the start of the movie, I was thinking, fuck this cat, what an asshole. But after hearing its struggles and motivations, I did a complete 180, which is really saying something because I don't like cats that much in general. The setting is the pottery town of Tokoname, and we do get to see lovingly detailed backgrounds within this setting. There is also the cat world that comes in later in the plot, and that allows the animators to flex their creativity. However, this world only appears for the last 10 minutes of the film, and that's after the emotional conflict has been resolved, so you won't get a very long look at it. So, I suppose a criticism would be that the last half could have entirely been set in this world so that it doesn't feel like an afterthought. But this movie is prevailingly sweet, and it should hopefully float your boat. Now, onto the relevant one. Burn the Witch is from the pen of Bleach author Tite Kubo, who I haven't really got much experience with, and instead my interest was piqued by this movie just based on the concept. Okay, it was the caliber of the studio. Okay. It was because
Niha was thick.
Burn the Witch is set in Reverse London, which is inhabited by witches, wizards, and dragons, the latter of which are responsible for 87% of the deaths, and so are contained by the organization Wingbind. In this organization lie our main characters, Ninny and Niha. Now, I described the plot, but it's over before it really gets going anywhere. One person has a dragon, then they're outlaws, then none of that mattered because it's over. I understand that calling this a movie is stepping onto a bit of a minefield because it was released as both an hour-long feature film and a three-episode OVA. But no matter how you look at it, the plot is not given long enough with which to do anything. And it doesn't help itself by introducing a metric fuckton of characters straight off the bat. Well, it's set in the UK, so I suppose it's more of a mixture of metric and imperial fucktons. However, this is down to Tite Kubo having started this as a one-off manga, and he says he's hoping to write a quote-unquote season 2. Now, despite the story being a little thin, the animation does keep it afloat, with stunning action sequences and lovely backgrounds, really bringing the city of Reverse London to life. A London that is also a coastal town now. Okay then. And I should also mention that there is one track that plays during the climax which is pretty hype, and does help to distract from all the deus ex machinas that are being pulled. But it's great being right because Niha, best girl. She is adorable, thick, and we even get a panty shot. Pog. I assume that if you are a Bleach fan, this will be a lot like how Gurren Lagann fans saw Promare, but I hope for an anime continuation, but that largely comes from a want for ideas to be expanded on, as I believe they haven't been fully achieved here. And that is Studio Colorido, who I theorize will one day have a film that will light the entire anime community on fire. But until they break into the spotlight, I have some thighs to stare at.